यूनिवर्सिटी वुमेन्स एसोसिएशन मद्रास। यत्र नार्यस्तु पूज्यन्ते रमन्ते तत्र देवता, सेज मनुस्मृति, मीनिंग वेयर वुमेन आर वर्शिप्ड देयर द गॉड्स रिजॉइस। लेट अस वर्शिप वुमेन एंड लेट अस एम्पावर आवर काइंड टू बी वर्शिप्ड। द एम्पावर्ड वुमेन इज पावरफुल बियॉन्ड मेजर एंड ब्यूटिफुल बियॉन्ड डिस्क्रिप्शन। As members of an organization that believes in empowering women through education, we all are here together today to celebrate 100 years in that notable cause, the noble cause. It is always an inspiration to listen to achievers talk about the paths they have traversed. That is a motivation to us as we trudge along our own. We have four such phenomenal women in our midst today. Honorable Justice Dr. Anita Suman, Madras High Court, who has honored our invite and joined us to preside over the webinar and deliver the inaugural address. Thank you, ma'am, and welcome you. It is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Rekha Shetty, Managing Director, Fastar Distribution Network Limited, Chennai. Dr. Vijayalakshmi, former head, Medical Sciences, National Institute for Empowerment of Persons with Multiple Disabilities, Muttukadu. Dr. Geeta Prem Kumar, Director, Vector Indogenics Private Limited, Chennai. Women of excellence who have carved for themselves a niche while enriching their community with their service. On behalf of the University Women's Association, Madras, I thank all of you for joining us. We look forward to listening to our esteemed speakers. I once again extend my greetings to Dr. Ranjana Banerjee, President, University Women's Association Asia and IFUA, Mrs. Gomati Venkateshwar, Vice President, IFUA, the Central Committee members, the presidents, and the ARs of all the University Women's Associations, and all its members who have joined us today. The University Women's Association Madras cordially welcomes you all to the webinar, Challenges for Women in the COVID Era.
Thank you, Lata ma'am, for the warm welcome. May I now invite Dr. Yashoda Shanmugasundaram, Vice President, the University Women's Association Madras, to introduce our esteemed chief guest, Honorable Dr. Justice Anita Suman.
A very good afternoon to everyone present here and everyone witnessing the meet. As IFYM is celebrating the centenary, I join with all my colleagues to send my felicitations to all associations connected with it, right from the top to the districts. It is my very pleasant opportunity today to be with you to introduce a lady who has climbed up to the highest level. Dr. Mrs. Anita Suman, the Honorable Justice of Madras High Court, is among us today to give her inaugural address. It is so much a pleasant day for us because we find in the legal profession, as much as in others, the same gender issues are paramount. And one has not only to smash the glass ceiling, but I believe there are several layers of glass ceilings to come up to that level. I congratulate Mrs. Honorable Justice Anita for having accomplished this. You are most welcome to our group, madam. Having become the permanent justice of the Madras High Court, she has given her best to the legal fraternity and legal practice and legal profession. As one who has known the family of Sumans for well over 3 decades, I also take it my personal opportunity to invite the daughter-in-law of the family of Vardarams. Madam, very hearty welcome. I doubly endorse the views that are expressed by our president, who has given such a beautiful welcome address to all of us. Madam Anita, I will take the liberty of calling you Anita. You please give me the liberty, because she has become a legal professional from out of a legal family. No doubt she is shining like a star in the horizon of legal system. She is an expert in taxation law, and again I reminisce, because I have been teaching taxation, public finance theory for so long, but I have not understood the ramifications of the practice of taxation law. Madam Anita, you are an expert in this line. Having extensively practiced all through the several lines of legal institutions, the next step, Anita, for you is Supreme Court. We all wish it that you will be the next person in the Supreme Court. Your expertise in direct and indirect access, taxation and corporate law has given you a very large client.
Yashoda ma'am, you're muted.
I can't
hear. Yashoda ma'am?
Can't hear.
Kindly unmute the microphone.
Is it
yes, ma'am. Yes,
audible?
Ma'am.
It's audible. Okay. And a leading legal professional and a justice of the High Court is the most welcome member among the University Graduates Association today. There are a large number of cases that you have attended, and one such case I want to bring out here is the case about the Employees State Insurance Act. You have done such a yeoman service to the employees of the aided educational institutions and private educational institutions in making them part of the ESI Act, which makes such a large contribution to that community which needs help. As part of the all-woman bench, it is our dream to see such all-woman dream always, and I think Madras High Court will have many more such episodes hereafter. You have done so well, and we congratulate you. Madam, your active interest in profession.
Again, Yashoda, you have to unmute.
Your mic, yes ma'am, you have to unmute.
We shall have a long session with you, learning all legal matters with you. You are most welcome among us, and particularly, I wish you some the justice system of our country will give fairness and
thank you, Yashoda ma'am. It is my privilege to welcome Honorable Dr. Justice Anita Suman to deliver the inaugural address.
Good evening to all of you. I hope my audio is clear.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, first of all. Thank you very much, Madam Yashoda, for such a warm and a personal introduction and welcome to this very esteemed gathering here today. Thank you very much. Dr. Lata Rajendran and the board of the University Women's Association Madras, Mrs. Maithili Sundar, at whose invitation I am here, esteemed and respected ladies, normally we say ladies and gentlemen. So out of force of habit, I was about to say ladies and gentlemen. And then I found that this was one instance where I need not use that phrase. So esteemed and respected ladies, thank you very much for this invitation. There is no greater pillar of stability than a strong, free and educated woman. It's been said. And how many thousands of such pillars has this association gifted to society? Just think about it. 100 years of educating women and facilitating their graduation, be it in the arts, be it in the humanities, be it in the sciences, year on year on year, consistently and quietly. The President, in her welcome address, mentioned the Manusmriti. And I found in the course of a little bit of reading that I have done on the history of empowerment of women, that in the earlier times, in fact, women were a lot more empowered than what we are today. And if you look at the Vedas, the Atharva Veda has a parallel of what we would perhaps today call a Charter of Women's Rights. There are a whole lot of couplets there which talk about the empowered woman, and they say that the best dowry to be given to a woman, forgive me for saying this, the best dowry to be given to a woman is education. And I guess over the course of years, we have now reached a position where if it were not for institutions like the institution that I am with today, the empowerment of women would perhaps leave a lot to be desired. It thus gives me the greatest of pleasure. It's a privilege to be amongst you at the start of this historic year, the centenary celebrations of this august association, and to flag it off. To sustain an association for 100 years is itself a great achievement. To sustain a service-oriented association that is actually and gainfully engaged in service for a century calls for the tipping of not just one hat, of several hats. So hats off to all of you. I always say that when I'm addressing any association which has the majority of its members as women, that when you have a virtual meet, the room will be packed with women achievers. And I've loved to be in such a room because of the energy that it generates. So I must equate that with my computer screen now, with so many glamorous and achievement-oriented women. I hope my screen doesn't explode. I've had the benefit of perusing the souvenir that is released 10 years ago at your 90th anniversary celebrations. And I'm simply amazed at the outstanding service that this association has been rendering towards women's education and empowerment. It's a cliche, but I must repeat it simply for the truth that it contains, that if you educate a man, you educate an individual. But if you educate a woman, you educate a family, you educate society, and you educate a nation. And that is what this association, precisely what this association has been doing silently and doggedly for over 100 years. Education for a woman, in my view, is not just to enable her to attain academic credentials or brilliance. And nothing will bring this fact to the fore, as do the events of the last nearly 2 years. Life, as we all know it, has changed in so many ways. We've had to cope, we've had to adjust, and we've had to adapt to survive. Of course, education brings to a woman confidence, perspective, the ability to come to the forefront, to take decisions, to assume responsibility for herself, her family, and those in her care. I find that all of these qualities that I've just now enumerated are oftentimes native to a woman. They don't require systemic or formal education. And in the little experience that I've had, the poise, the dignity, and the culture that we sometimes associate with formal education can surprise you with its appearance in the most unexpected situations and in the most unexpected persons. Let me give you a small incident. We have the advantage, when you are part of the institution that I am, to sit on different portfolios. We hear different kinds of matters. And that's precisely one of the reasons why elevation to judgeship posed so much of attraction to me. That rather than restrict yourself to one area of practice, Madam Yashoda mentioned my practice in taxation, there would be a great deal of exposure to other areas of the law as well. So I had the benefit of sitting with a doyen in criminal law, and we were hearing HCPs, that is habeas corpus petitions. I'm sure you all know what it is, but just to refresh, that is a petition which is filed when one wants to ask for the production of some person who one believes has been taken in contra to their will or irrespective of their volition. So I was sitting on the HCP bench, and there was one matter that had come up where parents had asked for the production of a woman who was 22 years old. So in a case of this nature, you will appreciate that the urgency is much more in the case of a minor, be it a girl or be it a boy. The urgency is perhaps more in the case of a minor. But that apart, since we are not sure whether the person has been taken against their will, normal procedure is to put law and order on the job. So we did that. And we asked the police to immediately find out what had happened. The apprehension in the mind of the parents was that the child had been taken away by a young gentleman with whom she had had some romantic association over the years. So the police got onto the job, they found them, and they produced them in court. And the girl was 22 years, the boy was about a couple of years older. And pending the HCP, and they had left their parental homes to get married. So they were married when they appeared before us. The parents were also before us. The family was a lower middle class family, not highly educated in the formal sense of the term. You will see why I am saying this presently. The father was a skilled worker. If I remember right, he was a carpenter. The mother was a homemaker, and both of them were distraught. The reason for they being distraught is this, that they had put their lives, efforts, resources, and everything that they had to ensure that the child got a graduation. She was, in fact, in the last year of her graduation. And that was when this incident had happened. So all they wanted was that the child should complete her education. And both the parents were trying to impress on the court that we should find a via media so that the child completes her education and then they can go back. The parents were unanimous in their statement that if only we had known about their intention to marry, we would have been very happy to facilitate it. So when we put this to the couple, in fact, our role as an HCP court is over. Once the couple was brought to the court, because both of them were majors and we have no further role in the matter at all. But sometimes we do try to facilitate a kind of a mediation, because what is important is to see that the family stays together and also to see that their married life is not started with a sort of acrimony in the family that has been caused. So when we asked the girl, see, these are the sentiments expressed by the parents. Why don't you complete your education? And then they will be happy to do whatever you want to, you know, have a formal wedding and do everything that's necessary. But the girl, perhaps with the brashness of youth, or call it what you may, she said, I am not interested in going back, because once I go back, they will make sure that we don't stay together. And I'm not interested in education anymore. The father broke down. What surprised us was the attitude of the mother. The mother was illiterate. She had had no formal education. She was so dignified, ladies. She was so dignified. And all she said was, I thought we had inculcated values in her for her to appreciate the value of education. We don't want any credit for what we have done, because it was our duty. But we had hoped that the efforts that we had put in would teach her the value of education. That graduation would have been useful as either a stepping stone to something bigger in education, or she may have utilized it in whichever way she felt best. But I only feel sorry that she has not understood that. She is now, as she continuously repeated, the child kept telling us, I am a major and I will not go back, and I cannot be forced to go back. And the mother said, we completely recognize that she's not in a position to be prevailed on to come back home. She has made her decision. It is her life. We wish her the best. And we want to make sure that she understands that our home is always available to her should she need it. And at which point, since things were getting a little emotional, we said, all of you think about what is being said and come back after a week. And when the parties reconvened after a week, we were very happy that sense had prevailed. And we don't know what had happened in the interim. Perhaps the girl mulled over what the mother had said in such a calm, composed and sensible way. And she said, yes, I'm going to complete my education. And thereafter, I will continue with whatever path I have taken for myself. I'm telling you this for two reasons. I'm telling you this because this is what you do. You facilitate a graduation, you facilitate an education, and you put women on the path to take proper decisions in their life. And the second reason why I wanted to say this was to highlight that a formal education is not the only thing that forms the backbone for dignity, poise, and the right frame of mind to take proper decisions. And we saw it in that woman the other day. Speakers to follow are going to talk to us about the impact that the pandemic has had on women entrepreneurs. I see Mrs. Rekha Shetty here. We've had a long association earlier, and I hope you're doing well. Women with disabilities, both physical and psychological. There have been many other specific points of impact as far as this pandemic has had. Domestically, women have had a rough time in many situations. There are safety and security issues. I'm just naming a few of the many that have cropped up. For my part, I thought I will touch upon very briefly what I saw as its impact on professionals. And when I say professionals, I'm talking about doctors and lawyers. Doctors, because they've been such an integral part of all the fabric of all our lives over the past 1.5 years. And lawyers, because that's part of my day. I see the pandemic as having had a great leveling influence. This is not to say that the battles of women are over and the glass ceiling is shattered, not by a long shot. But when you think of it, today when you see a doctor or a nurse, or when you think of them, you just think of them as a demigod without reference to gender, perhaps an ardhanari. But you hardly think of whether it's a lady or a male. You just think of them as professionals who have risen to the occasion and who have come to the forefront and done what is necessary to keep us all together. As I was saying, in some ways, the pandemic, the great leveler. One of the silver linings of the pandemic has been that of virtual interaction. And this is certainly a boon to all professionals. Now, I can speak with reference to the judicial system. We courts have had to work virtually, and lawyers have simply blossomed in the new medium. In fact, video conferencing is not new to the judicial system, and we have had video conferences sporadically over the last perhaps 1.5 decades. You know, many of our courts have got satellite courts. The Bombay High Court has got a satellite court. The Karnataka High Court has got satellite courts. We have got a satellite court in Madurai. So in many cases where there is a spillover, when we travel to the other jurisdiction, to the other location, we do, to maintain continuity, we hear the matters over video conference. So that's not a novelty to us. But now it has become the only way to conduct a hearing. And therefore, we have had to up our act. We have had to ensure that there are video conferencing rules and people are all aware of the way in which the best and the optimum way to make this medium work. There have been instances, for instance, we have never thought about having a dress code as part of the video conference rules, because when you appear physically in a court, we all know what the dress code is. But when somebody appears from their home, sometimes they forget to strike that balance between appearing before a court while being at home. So we have had people appear before us.
Even with shorts.
And then we have had to tell them.
And some of them were viewed counsels. They were just wearing shorts also in the house.
Casually dressed. Casually dressed. And we have had to, in fact, make a stipulation that it may be over a video conferencing medium, but it is still a court hearing. So we have learned to adapt to the new times. And the advantages as far as the legal professionals are concerned are great saving in time, travel being rendered redundant, the ability to appear in various fora, tribunals, courts, all while moving from one room to another in your own office in the same location. And there is a consequent increase as far as the security for women are concerned. All the threats and dangers that come with travel are also eliminated to a great extent. The benefits are huge. There are so many talented and ambitious women out there based in small towns, villages. Traditionally, they are looked at as feeder advocates to urban councils, lawyers who are based in the cities. What they will do is to conduct their case in their own location. And if the matter travels in appeal, the file is then handed over to somebody who is based in the city for them to handle the matter. And what held the councils in the smaller locations back was a lack of resource to travel to the city courts, consequently a lack of opportunity. Not anymore. At the touch of a button, they can appear now anywhere in any court. And the sky is truly their limit now. I can't tell you how happy this makes me. We have a judicial academy in the state of Tamil Nadu. We have a board of governors of which I am part. And we recently conducted interviews to recruit research assistant and research fellows. And because the medium was virtual, we had people, children, students, appearing before us from the smallest of villages in the state of Tamil Nadu. Connectivity, data is an issue, no doubt. There are challenges, but we are rising to meet them all. There was one child who was appearing from a small village in Kanyakumari, and the weather was very bad. Her connectivity was very bad. But she had the confidence to tell us, "Madam, I want to ensure that I'm able to be heard and I participate in the interview. Will you please wait till I find the best spot in my house where the connectivity is good?" And we said, "Yes, we will wait." And we traveled with that child from room to room of her house till she found the best spot where we could hear her and she could hear us. That, I think, is a brilliant spin-off from this pandemic. I know it's perhaps wrong to see anything good in it at all, but then as human beings, we have to be optimistic and we have to see the silver lining in all situations. Women have demonstrated that they have the innate ability to lead, to rise to the occasion and adapt seamlessly to new situations. We are seeing that today. And we, as those with privilege, who have traveled on the shoulders of many women before us to reach where we are, we must do all that we can to mentor them and to guide them. How we perform in this task, particularly in these trying times, is for history to tell us. That report card is yet to come. To want to give back is not a very rare quality. I think many of us do it individually in our little small ways. But to do it collectively as an association for a century is rare and priceless and almost divine in its impact. It was Omar Khayyam who said, "The moving finger writes, and having writ moves on. Nor all thy piety nor wit shall lure it back to cancel half a line, nor all thy tears wash out a word of it." But as far as the script of this association is concerned, I don't think you should want to move back even a single alphabet or a word, because you have scripted and you are continuing to script history for over 100 years. In doing so, you have charted momentous paths for scores of women and families. You've changed destinies for the better, and you've catalyzed many to stride ahead to the finish line. I feel very privileged to be part of the journey of your association, and I have the greatest privilege in inaugurating the centenary celebrations of the University Women's Association, Madras. May your tribe increase. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for reiterating the role of education and technology as a key to women's empowerment, which can bring about a positive attitudinal change. And ma'am, you also made us realize how to march ahead with all our might, definitely with the right spirit and in the right direction. Madam, on behalf of everyone here today, I thank you for taking your time to be part of the virtual celebrations of the University Association of Madras. Thank you, ma'am. Can COVID-19 be the turning point for women entrepreneurs in India? To make us understand how women's entrepreneurship can be a catalyst for change in their economic role in India, we have amidst us Dr. Rekha Shetty, Managing Director, Faster Distribution Network Limited, Chennai. A warm welcome to you, ma'am. I now invite Dr. Rajalakshmi, the Vice President, the University Women's Association, Madras, to introduce our guest speaker, Dr. Rekha Shetty.
Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Madam Ranjana Banerjee, the President of IFWA, and Lada Rajendran, Secretary Anita, and all the office bearers, it is my present duty to introduce such a vibrant, dynamic innovator, Rekha Shetty, to the audience, the elite audience of University Women Association. Madam, apart from your brief biodata, I went through Google, along the Google to search about you. Certain interesting facts are there. Actually, as it was introduced, you are the main person, mind power. The mind power and innovation you meant together to making women how they are successful. But anyway, I have to say a little deeds of you. That is, there are so many. Very briefly, I will list it out. The Foster Distribution Network, she is the MD, and she's the first woman governor to get in Asia award from the Rotary Asia. She has written books on innovation and blue chips corporations. So these are the hard areas, hardships, the area of men. I don't know how you are managing all these things. And she is very popular for turning ideas into letters and innovations. There is also a recipient of PhD of from Madras University, where I had my 30 years of innings as a director, head of the Department of Economics. Really surprising to note, she is also a syndicate member of Anna University, and she is in board of all B schools. I think that is a success. The B schools are performing so well, I believe. All the business schools, the top running 10 business schools, she is in the board. She is teaching the students and making new innovators. Madam, come little down to our college students, arts colleges and all, and teach them how to innovate also, apart from the B school. And another very surprising another thing I have noticed is she has visited, she has been sent to US in a leadership program on, that is addiction, that is how to come out of addiction. Hope you are having a center for addiction also, no? Addiction, to come out of addiction, how to heal an addiction also. That I couldn't find whether you are having it or not, but she has represented US along with an international team for addiction, that is the how to deal with addiction and all. So that is a very threatening problem in Tamil Nadu because of all the TASMAC and the government revenue from it. So madam, you have to do more heading ways into it. She is consultant in nearly 15 or 16 enterprises, very top enterprises, ICICI Bank, Ashok Leyland, TVS Group, Indian Oil Corporation, Blue Chips Innovation, and she's also having another line she has taken on, Happiness Drive and Happiness Calculation, and she is also writing on it. So madam, so much things are to your laurels, and we are happy to welcome you. And really, I think you must be having a good, you please tell us, what is the secret behind your success story? So that will help all the University Women Association members. We had the story of our Mina Muthaya. Mina Muthaya is a person. It is a by data, she must be having a belief. And actually, even she's in different fields. But anyway, we are having people like Manu Patasha and Mahali Nagarai, and so many people, and also in all India level. So please, actually, the other group, the little group, who are active now, we would like to tell them, how you are giving consultations to so many companies, what you are giving consultation, and what you can give to us also. Please, madam, very nice to introduce you in this afternoon group of University Women Association. This is Rajalakshmi, Professor Rajalakshmi. Now, okay, I'm also a multidisciplinary personality. Thank you. Welcome you.
Rekha Shetty ma'am, can you please unmute your microphone? Thank you, ma'am.
I don't know whether Dr. Rajalakshmi has done a PhD on Rekha Shetty and found out so many things which even I don't know about. Thank you, Dr. Rajalakshmi.
I am a researcher.
I can see that. You have researched me thoroughly on the net, and thank you very much for your introduction, Dr. Lata Rajendran, Shyamasree Sen, a past president of the University Association for Women, and all the dignitaries you have here, Dr. Banerjee, all the people here were gathered to celebrate the most extraordinary thing, the most extraordinary gift that can make a woman a goddess, and that is education. We heard from Anita, the judge, who is a who's someone I really admire. She sings so beautifully. I wish we had listened to her singing one of her Carnatic Kritis. Such a beautiful musician and such a great legal luminary. I want to talk to you about something that is very practical that you can use immediately, and I would be very happy to work with your association to help women to innovate, because this is a period of time, the cusp of history, where all the things that held us back are now removed from our path. Madam Anita, I think if I was in the court with her, in front of her, I would have to bow to her, and probably, you know, when you speak to a judge, I think you, what do you call them? Your Lordship. I would like to say here that what you said is absolutely true. All the obstacles in our path have been removed by the COVID crisis. Carl Sagan, the great scientist, said that every human being has the capacity to store the equivalent of 7,550 volumes of Encyclopedia Britannica. That is the power of the mind. 7,550 volumes of encyclopedia are gifted to you at birth. And whether you access that vast computer or not depends on you. One can sit in a library with 7,550 volumes of Encyclopedia Britannica and sleep and not open a single book. That is what happens when we stop learning once we get our degrees. And this happens very often in the Indian context. We do not continue to refresh and learn and keep in touch with the latest technologies. The brain has no sexual orientation. The brain is pure knowledge. And the more you put into that computer, the more you can get out of the computer. I ask you, during this period of the COVID-19, which has, you know, seemingly put us into the sanctuary of our homes, I ask you to use this time to develop and improve that mind computer. All the women you know, please make sure that they expand and increase their knowledge and do things they've never done before. Because suddenly you have a lot more time. You're not traveling. You're not going somewhere else. Do you realize that about 3 hours every day is spent in commuting to your place of work, and several hours when you're going to some other place, some other city? Use all this time to develop your mind computer. I think total focus on learning, on Goddess Saraswati, experiencing the meaning of what knowledge can do to the human mind. This is what you should do during the COVID-19. And develop the ability to meditate. Because only when you wipe the mind clean, can you focus and learn more and more. Learn meditation. Learn to use your mind. My company over the last 28 years, has developed the mental thinking toolkit with 47 thinking tools, and innovation centers have been developed in different universities. I offer this opportunity for any one of you who want to set up an innovation center in your college or your university. And we can train people on the net to start using these thinking tools to change life. Now, how can a person sitting at home do things which are completely different? How can they become entrepreneurs? You can see that around yourself, women have stepped out of their normal jobs to create another job. You know, in the 70s, Alvin Toffler wrote Future Shock. It was a book where he exactly, like an astrologer, he foresaw everything that's happening during COVID-19. He said, the time will come then when all the people who were dragged from their homes to be sacrificed on the altar of technology during the Industrial Revolution will be brought back to their homes, which will be now. I am fine. Daud, switch off. Thank you. So, thank you. So, what has happened now is we have reversed the process and come home. And the home has become this electronic cottage. We are, Shyamashri will tell you that we are in touch with countries all over the world. In a single day, we visit 3 or 4 countries through the internet, because Rotary is in 172 countries. I find it very liberating. So if your dream was to take your idea to many countries, this is the time to do it. This is the time to do it. And you know why women will be at their best during this period? It's because of the emotional software that has been developed in us from childhood. If a child who cannot do anything, you know, human baby is one of those creatures which requires constant care. We have to educate, look after, love, feed that child. And so we become very patient. I'm saying that women are going to enter the workplace and revolutionize the workplace as never before, because suddenly men are asked to develop the soft skills, the skills, the matchless software of the human heart. They're called upon to develop that. Men are now questioned about their capacity to love, to care, and to protect and nurture. Look at the Ardha Narishwara context, Ardha Narishwara model. Everybody is both male and female. Everybody needs the capacity to love and to care. But unfortunately, in the corporate world, this capacity was not developed at all. People were taught to be hard as nails. You know, male boss who's very tough and rough and rude became a role model, but no more. If you look at the, you know, ad which was so popular, the Complete Man, the Raymond Man, what did it say? It said the man needs to develop his emotions, the capacity to cry, the capacity to look after a small baby, the capacity to understand. These were again put back where they should really be put in human discourse. Human discourse requires people to be sensitive, affectionate, loving, caring, supportive. So men are now challenged to develop all these concepts. As far as women are concerned, I think we heard the Honorable Judge talk about professionalism. Whatever job you do, definitely education is a job of professionals. Be good at it. Be the best at it. Keep learning. Keep refreshing whatever you know. Reach out, look for more, you know, more qualifications, and develop everybody along with you. Take them along with you, because this is something which you will really do well. So what are the ways in which women can become entrepreneurs? First, in the sharing of knowledge. All of you have the most fantastic portfolio of knowledge created over the years. Reach out, learn something new. Like the other day, I got hold of a little Oxford French dictionary. So my granddaughter said, "Why do you want this, Doda?" I said, "I want to learn a new language. I'm not sure I'm going to learn French, but definitely if I go to France, I'm going to use the words that I find here." Learning all the time creates neural connections. This is what my friend, the neurologist and neurosurgeon, Preetika Chari, tells me. She says, Every time you learn something new, new connections are built. A person who's learning all the time, you know, the mind does not age. You do not get Alzheimer's. You don't get all the diseases that happen when you stagnate, when you don't do anything. And then I want you to focus sharing your knowledge. Monetize it. Your knowledge has a price. Monetize it. At the simplest levels, it's tuition. At a higher level, it is discussion groups, developing people, you know, helping them with their PhDs. I know how difficult it was. It took me 7 years to do my PhD from Rajalakshmi's University, head of the Department of Management. Satyanarayanan was my teacher, and luckily, I just got my PhD, and then he fell very ill, and you know, we lost him also. Use your use the digital world to go out and help people to complete their PhD. Give more guidance, you know, develop more guidance. People be willing to pay for anything where they're learning more. Then I want to bring you to a very important point. The most important point during this period, what do you think people really feel and what do they lack during the COVID-19? Just guess. People are lonely. Do you agree? People are lonely. They don't really feel the need for human company. You know, the other day I read a beautiful book by Ishigaro. He's a great Japanese writer, and he wrote about Carla and the Sun. It's written, you know, the name of the book is Carla and the Sun. Fabulous book. You know who Carla is? Carla is a AF. An AF is an artificial friend. You know that they're talking about a future time. The child has been chosen, designer child. Like the parents chose that child according to certain genetic permutations because they wanted a model child, you know, a ready-made modern child with all the qualities they have in mind. But see, you cannot choose qualities like that. You know what happens? The child has horrible health, very brilliant, very intelligent, but then all sorts of physical, because that is the combination they've chosen, and she is unable to make friends. So they go to a shop and they buy an artificial friend. That artificial friend is digital, and she learns everything about the child as you go along. Just like we learn about our friends, the doll Carla starts learning everything about. And it's such a fascinating thing to think that there will be a time in our lives when we will need artificial friends, digital friends. Why don't we become real friends? Keep in touch with all the people you've loved, all the people you've cared about in the past. Tell them, you know, write a love letter to your mother. First thing, write a love letter to your mother. Write a love letter to all the friends you've had who have changed your life, who have created a whole new world for you. Do that today. And about business. See, my neighbor is a postgraduate. She finds she's not able to do anything at home. She has started a cake business, and that business is by order. People call and place an order, and she'll make model cakes, fabulous cakes. And you know what? She's so successful, her son has resigned his job and come and joined her. Now he is going for a program in Switzerland to learn all about chocolates. I'm saying the sky is the limit. Sky is not the limit. You can do anything you want, because what you need today is a portfolio of jobs. Just because you're teaching in a university doesn't mean that you should not explore other areas of yourself, which can be fueled by digital areas. Think about it. Today you find that people, you know, the Baiju's app, it was such a small app some years ago. Today it has gone global because people are looking for ways to learn. people are looking for ways to be coached. Last week, I met a friend who's just joined Rotary. She's a health coach. I said, what do you do? She said, if you sign up with me for a certain value, you know, membership, I will coach you to become healthier in the next 3 months. What will it cost? 15,000 rupees. A coach. You can become a coach. Because one thing you've had is experience. Another thing you've had is emotional intelligence. You have learned to master the Navarasas. You know, Lata Rajendran is a well-known dancer. She may not have told you, but she's a Kalai Mahamani, which is a great thing, you know. It's a government recognition. To control the five Navarasas, the positive Navarasas, love, compassion, courage, peace, attraction, all the positive rasas you can develop and use during this time. And you know, there are people who are teaching dance on the net. My neighbor, who's 82, is learning taekwondo. Not learning, she's practicing taekwondo on the net, Revati. And she is always an adventurer. You know, she used to be the principal of a school. Then I found she was working on terracotta sculptures with the Lalit Kala Academy. And now, because she can't go anywhere, she is doing taekwondo on her terrace. Fabulous garden she has. And we chat over the fence. And what I like to see her also. Fabulous. So, I want to tell you that we need to remove ourselves from the space we have inhabited in the past. We forget that we keep on changing. You know, intensive motherhood, intensive, you know, care of the home. They're only for short periods. It's not something that you can fall back on and say, oh, I'm looking after everything. And you've got everything. You've got everything systematic. Now do something else. Get a portfolio of things to do. Develop your mind. Get into exercise mode. Do things that will bring out the energy of you. See, finally, you are responsible only for yourself. Gomati, do you agree? You reach a stage when you're responsible only for yourself. At least become, you know, like have the excitement of enjoying that, you know, the capacity to be responsible for yourself, to give to others, doing whatever it is you want to do. And I want to say, first of all, love yourself. Congratulate yourself that you have reached this stage. Do you know how tough it is to manage all the things you have managed in your life? Congratulate yourself first. First and foremost, congratulate yourself. Bringing up children, looking after the house, having a career, studying. You've done all that. So look at yourself and say, Drishti. Drishti means nobody should cast eyes on you. Drishti, I'm saying. Huh? All of you have come out of it looking so fabulous. Look at you. Congratulate yourself. Anyone wants to put you down, tell them to get lost. Get lost. Because I've done it. I've done it with my life. Start writing, I'm saying. Shyamashri is a poet. And that is even more difficult than prose. Each of you has the capacity to write. See, don't be overwhelmed with the Shakespeare's and the Bernard Shaw's of this world. Don't. You have your own voice. You don't have to be a Tagore. You can be whoever you are. You can be Vaijayanti. You can be Sunanda. You can be Rajalakshmi. You can be Gauri. Just, oh, I don't know how to get it published. Why do you care? Write for yourself, I'm saying. Write for all your friends. Take your history. Open it out. Let your grandchildren read all the things that you did. Just do it. Write about your life. What have you learned in your life? Why is it that you have so little confidence? You know, the problem with us women is we have no confidence in ourselves. Low confidence in ourselves. You know, when I was working in Apollo, Vice President Apollo Hospital, we brought out a checkup for women. And in that, we showed a lovely woman, and we addressed it to the men. We said, you know, your wife may be feeling tired. She may be, you know, having problems with energy. You know, whatever. Why don't you bring her for a checkup? We put a front page ad. And in that front page ad, you know, it's very expensive. In the Hindu, we put it. And guess what? Next day, everybody was waiting. No women came. So wondering why. And then when Dr. Reddy said, you know, these women are not bothered about themselves. Why should we bother? Let's put an ad for the men. Executive health checkup. Find out your husband's chance of getting a heart attack in the next 5 years. Believe it or not, next morning, how many men do you think came? All accompanied by their wives. And some guy said, she said not to come home unless I do the checkup. And then we said, what is this? What is the matter? Why is this happening? It's because we all have this, you know, Sati Savitri complex, that we feel we should be sacrificing, we have to be, I don't know what it is. But I tell you, the persons who suffer the most when we are not well, when we are not full of energy, is the family. The children, the husband, the home, everything suffers when women are not able to, you know, achieve their full Shakti. You know, we say Shakti, but what Shakti? Hemoglobin of 7.5. And I'm not talking about corporation sweepers. I'm talking about you guys. 8 of 8 hemoglobin. God alone knows. And some of the doctors look at the hemoglobin and say, what on earth is this? The last to eat. Eat all the rubbish that nobody else is eating because fridge is getting full of rubbish. Correct, na? So then we put an ad in the paper and it was at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 2 to 4. When nobody needs them, right? And we put an ad and we said, what will this child do if something happens to you? And the child had a tear in its eye. You will not believe, groups of women start coming. 2 o'clock was a good time, 2 to 4, because nobody needs them at that time. It's their nap time. They're coming. And we were able, but even today, the well woman checkup has never caught up like the executive health checkup or the men's checkup. It is what we feel about ourselves. We have to love ourselves. Buy good things for ourselves. Eat well. I'm not saying eat up everything before they come. Not that. Eat all your favorite stuff. Take your tonics. Go see the doctor. One, I spoke to my friend and I said, when did you see? Have you seen the gynecologist? She said, why? I had my babies long ago. Why should I see a gynecologist? You need to see a gynecologist just once a year. You need to do a pap smear. If you want to survive the 70s, 80s and 90s, and you will survive sometimes in a miserable state. I'm saying if you want to survive in good shape, get all this done. So I want to come back to this thing. First, love yourself. Love all the others. Help them come up to your level. I mean the cooks, the drivers and all the people who come to you hoping that you're going to improve their lives. Encourage them to get their kids educated, help them with this thing, develop everybody along with you. Imagine how thrilled you will feel when you're 90 and you have this army of people you've developed all around you. Say, Amma, I'll never forget you. And finally, love learning. That I don't have to tell you because you are devoted to learning. Love learning. Every day learn something new. And innovation, I want you to do one thing every day which you have not done before. Talk to one person you have never talked to before. Work on one thing which you have never done before. Eat something which you have never tried before. Don't become a creature of habit. Don't become so boring that nobody wants to talk to you. Have some new adventure in your life every day. And I want to wish you, each and every one of you, a brand new person in this brand new world that is being presented to us. A world that is swift, digital, at the speed of thought. That is Bill Gates. At the speed of thought. things which you can do sitting back in the most beautiful and wonderful place in the world, and that is your own home. I think, why go to the resort? Why can't you make your home like a resort? And I tell you, it's all in the mind. If you think your home is like a resort and you do everything that you do in resorts in the house, it will become like that. If you think I have to leave this place, go very far away, suffering all sorts of risks like COVID to go to a resort, no, I'm saying, create a resort around you. Create a place that is so wonderful, magnetic and beautiful that everybody wants to be with you. Thank you very much, and God bless you as you look forward to this brand new life that awaits you right from this moment.
Thank you, Rekha ma'am. Your address has reminded me of one of the inspiring quotes of Swami Vivekananda. The infinite library of the universe is in your own mind, and the object of study is always in your mind. Certainly, your inspirational words has made us realize how to learn from the crisis and adapt for uncertainty, which are the key to tide over the crisis now. And also for sharing your valuable insights on the resources women can adapt in the COVID times to maintain a strong, optimistic outlook. Thank you once again, ma'am, and we are really honored to have you amongst us today. On 11th March 2020, when the World Health Organization declared COVID-19 a pandemic, it was clear that the world was in the midst of a global health emergency. Many women and girls with disabilities experienced barriers to meet their needs and fulfill their rights. To brief on the unique challenges faced by women due to disabilities during pandemic, our next speaker, Dr. Vijayalakshmi, former head medical scientist, Nitesh Chennai, has joined us. I invite Ms. Maithili Sundar, Constitution Advisory, the Indian Federation of University Women's Association, to introduce our speaker.
Good evening, all of you. Dr. Vijayalakshmi, thank you very much for accepting the invitation extended by University Women Association Madras and consented to be part of our centenary celebrations. A very warm welcome to you. Dr. Vijayalakshmi is the former head of the Department of Medical Sciences in the National Institute of Empowerment of Persons with Multiple Disabilities. A renowned medical doctor who transformed herself into a rehabilitation officer to start a career in the field of social work. Her interest in rehabilitation work is commendable. She is blessed with the right values to work in social care and with the practical knowledge gained through her personal experience. Dr. Vijayalakshmi has achieved her goals of helping those within her community through multiple outreach programs. Dr. Vijayalakshmi has profound knowledge in early identification, referrals, training, HRD training. As a great parent trainer, she has trained many parents to be their children's best behavior therapists. As an active researcher, she has worked on the causes of sleep disorders and designed many national and international posters. Her ambitious nature drove her to train more professionals in early intervention centers of Tamil Nadu. She's coordinated the course of DET and PGDEI. She is actively involved in the placement of trainees. Dr. Vijayalakshmi has contributed to developing appropriate curriculum for teacher training in deaf blindness and has been conferred with 3 awards for her dedicated work in the field of rehabilitation. She explored her knowledge by writing chapters for the NCERT and the State Center for Educational Research and Training on multiple disabilities and through television programs and brochure branding created awareness on rehabilitation. It's an honor to have such an eminent personalities amongst today. Once more, I welcome you, Dr. Vijayalakshmi.
Thank you, madam. Can you see my slides, madam?
Can we?
Ma'am, we are not able to see your slides, but we can see your screen.
Okay, now. One second, give me one second.
Sure.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you see now? Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
The first slide is there or second slide is there, ma'am? It is the disability or?
It's the first title slide, ma'am.
Now it is?
Yes, ma'am.
Next slide, no, ma'am? Yeah, thank you. So, Honorable Justice Dr. Anita Sumant, Dr. Geeta, Dr. Rekha Shetty, Dr. Lata Rajendran, Madam Maitli, all the esteemed members of the University Association, Women's Association, and all the members, a very good evening to one and all of you. And I thank Lata Madam for giving this opportunity to me. It is, you know, the first slide shows that there are 21 disabilities. And it is actually, you know, I am in with NIPMED, which is the National Institute for Multiple Disabilities. And we deal with all the 21 disabilities.
Vijayalakshmi ma'am, sorry to interrupt. We are not able to see the slides.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, one second. Now can you see?
No, ma'am.
And also the slide, it's very, we can't see much also.
Ma'am will, Lakshmi ma'am will try to present it. So there was some problem. I'm not able to do it from here.
Okay, ma'am. Yes.
So I've sent it to Lakshmi ma'am and Lakshmi ma'am will try to visit. But there are 21 disabilities and we deal with all the different combination of disabilities. Actually, our institute is more dealing persons with more than one disability in them. So what happens is that we had, you know, during the COVID time, we faced many challenges. Actually, we had very difficult times and we faced many challenges. But in spite of the challenges, actually, the mothers and the family members really did well. Because I want to quote that out of the almost all the 21 disabilities, you know, there was problems like not able to get services, not able to reach the center, not able to access the internet, and not able to attend the virtual classes. So there were lots of problems faced by the parents and the family members. And, you know, they were trying to contact us. So what the institute did is we went to their home, you know, as a mobile unit. And even that was stopped when totally when the there was a stopping of all the, you know, transport system also. So what the parents did is they really worked on, they watched the videos and they worked on their children. And tremendous impact was there in a few families, you know, there was tremendous impact. And we found that children with, you know, deaf blindness, that is the first slide I put actually, the girl having a deaf and blind because she was born to a person who had a this congenital German measles at the time of pregnancy, and she gave birth to a child with a vision, hearing, and heart problem. That was corrected, and she's being educated at NIPMED, and also she attends a regular school. So what happens was the regular school was shut off, and she was coming to NIPMED, and she was actually wanting to appear for her ninth standard exam. So, and after that, you know, she couldn't attend, you know, and she came to NIPMED. And this within this 1 year, so she could actually, she was trained at NIPMED. And she was, because in 1:1 ratio, her teacher is fortunately or unfortunately is a man, actually. Next slide, ma'am. Actually, Actually, the teacher is a person, you know, who has deaf blindness. So he will teach the girl and the girl will learn
and will go and practice at home. The mother also sits along with all the classes because she is not able to see the this phone, cell phone, or understand what the teacher is telling. So the close contact was really necessary even during the pandemic. A distance of less than 2 meters has to be there to teach a child with deaf blindness. So this girl, you know, actually learned everything, and she was about to appear for the 10th this year. And finally, the announcement came that she has got an all pass, and she's now successfully completed that. Actually, she was aiming at a pass mark because both the parents and the child and the teacher were really struggling to get a pass in 10th standard. And we know that she will get through. But finally, when the government announced, she was very, very happy because she was able to get a pass in 10th. Now she wanted to go for higher studies, and thinking about the challenges, you know, she really thought that she will not do that because she will in fact do a small course like the caregivers course in the NIPMED itself, in our institute itself, where, you know, the caregiver is taught to handle with these 21 disabilities. Children with different disabilities, and this course is a short course. Those who have done 10th standard can go up to, it's a 10 months course for them. If you have done less, you know, you can do 6 months and finish it off. So we thought, let her do the 6 months course and get ready for taking the challenge children and to deal with that. So next slide, ma'am. Yeah, this is again, it is her only. And again, next slide, ma'am. Yeah, this is a new girl who has come to us, you know. She came back, she came to us 3 months before. And she has got a vision problem due to high pressure in the eye. And her name, she has undergone operation, but it is not successful. So she has actually difficulty in seeing. One eye is okay. The other eye is actually has gone bad, you know, actually really bad. There is no vision in it, and she has hearing impaired. And the teacher, you know, teacher has done her diploma in special education for teaching children with deaf blindness. And the blue dress is the teacher, who is a teacher with specialization in teaching children with deaf blindness. And the girl whom you are seeing facing us is the girl who is deaf as well as low vision, actually. And she's going to appear now, you know, coming 10th standard. And she needs large letters, and she needs magnifiers. And we have every equipment to give her a magnified image. But she needs, you know, sign language. So a distant education is not possible. Though the teacher is trying to teach the mother, actually she has to come to the institute to have a follow-up lessons in her life, actually. But she will be, and she's so empowered that she's so happy that she will be able to do 10th standard. Because when she came to us, she was so depressed that she will not be able to do her 10th standard. Next slide, ma'am. Yeah, this is, you know, when people are not having ability to come to the institute, people go to their house, and the teacher going to the house of a child with cerebral palsy and celebrating Onam, you know. So actually, the teacher went there to make the child happy, you know. You know, such children with disabilities, they need closeness and they need close interactions because, you know, they are not able to see this net, you know, and not able to understand what we are telling. If you have a hearing impairment or a visual impairment, or you are really having an intellectual disability. So with this teacher, I appreciate so much that she went to her house and did, the child is on the wheelchair, and she celebrated the festival with her. Next slide, ma'am. Yeah, this is a really an empowering mother, and the child is, you know, that blue shirt, and she's actually has gone into the Guinness Book of World Records because 3 days she has non-stop recited the Tirukural, and she has done. She was the first student in NIPMED, this early intervention unit. She has she's blind as well as she has autism, and her father left her because he doesn't want want to have a child like this. So the mother who is standing near, she's educated. She's not a graduate, but you know, she learned all the tricks of teaching a child with visual impairment and autistic features. Now she's she has empowered her so well. She's a well-known figure all over the world now. And she knows how to create, this symphonies and all, which, Beethoven was only doing it. And such, children with blindness and autism has got, some people have giftedness. And this girl is extremely gifted. And they were really very, very, economically, they were very down. Now that she is recognized all over the world and she gets a very good support, and she did her music from the music college in Chennai. And next slide, please, ma'am. And this is a girl with a cerebral palsy, She was really lying down and coming. But I present this because she was very well empowered. But we lost her due to a COVID attack, because when child is having a cerebral palsy, that is the tightness of the muscle, the breathing capacity is very less. So what happened was, her house is a very small house and there are no windows, and in the night, she has taken heavy food and she was not able to breathe. Because of oxygen less, she developed seizures and she died. And the mother called me at 2:00 to carry the body to Tiruchendur, where she their home is. Actually, they all came to NIPMED because they wanted to educate the child, And they were not able to carry the child's body to their native place because the person was asking a lot of money from them. So we thought we will raise it, but suddenly, those people who are staying around, they said you can have your cremation here itself because we will give you land, and that is on the ECR road, and so the child's body was cremated there, and she was so much, she came up so much, and because of COVID we lost her. So next slide, please. This is a child with a Patau syndrome. So the genetic cause, and she has low vision, hearing impairment, and difficult jaw movements, and she has mild intellectual disability also. But she has vision to understand. We were really surprised that, as our previous speaker said, that people have really started using the net so much. And they are able to virtually come and meet, they are able to learn through Zoom, This girl has really started learning. And though she's sitting very far away from NIPMED, her house is in Viripuram, but she has started learning because the teacher knows the tricks of teaching a child with deafblindness. Next slide, ma'am. Yeah, this child is actually from MGR College, and she is only hearing impaired. And she was so lucky during the pandemic that Vaishnava Janado saw, she did it in sign as well as she did the Bharatanatyam. And she got a very good amount, and actually we offered this chance to a little more poorer child from the same college. But she had so much of inhibition, and she didn't come up. But this girl came up and she did the dancing, and it was watched all throughout India, and it was also projected in the YouTube. And she's from MGR Janaki College, and she has completed her graduation, and in spite of her disability, she is able to learn dance and also do dancing and imitate the song Vaishnava Janado in sign language. Next slide, ma'am. And this child, I want you to listen, because this is a teacher, this blue dress and white the dupatta, she is a teacher, and she has a disorder called Marfan syndrome, and she cannot give birth, and she has done her diploma in deafblindness. She's a teacher for deafblind children. Now she lost her job because the school is shut. And she is not getting another job because she is having, she cannot leave the place from where she is, and she belongs to the fisherman community. So the mother is not sending her to any other place, and no special school is open now. And she has Marfan syndrome, and her reproductive organs are not well developed. She cannot get married. She has a heart disease for which she has undergone a surgery, and she has vertebral backbone deficit. She has undergone a surgery for backbone, and you know she's at home. No, and only two people are there at home who were earning, and both of them are at home. And you know, we have been sending some people to get tuition, but from the area where she is staying, you know, no rich persons are there who can take her as a teacher for a home tuition. But luckily, last week, you know, I got a parent came with a child who has a specific learning disability, and I said, this teacher will teach you. You please contact her. She will come to your house, or you go to her house, or you have a virtual meet. So, you know, people, I mean, we have to, as rightly said, you know, we have to empower people, you know, by giving them a little bit of push. And that's what Lata Madam has done, and all people, and my former speakers have done. But, you know, this will really help, you know, a family to come up, and the people who are depending on the teacher to develop more, you know. So, yes, rightly said, our Justice Ma'am also said that education is very, very important. Next slide, Ma'am. Yeah, this is me and a child with biotinase deficiency. The father doesn't take care of them because both mother and the child has got hair falling disorder, low vision and seizures. So, and you know, in the pandemic, they got stranded. Next slide, Ma'am. And next one, please. Their house, you know. I know. Go to the last map. Little more ahead. Yeah, one more slide. Where this child's home is there, ma'am. So I'll tell you the story. So, yeah, this child. Okay, keep this only. That child, blue child only you keep. The previous one, ma'am. This child has got biotinidase deficiency, which is an inborn error of metabolism. So there is an enzyme defect, and the hair will fall, and you have mental retardation, and you have low vision, you know. And we went to and we directed our teachers to go to her house, and there was, you know, the heavy rains during the pandemic, and her house almost was submerged, and you know, we could help her out by giving a rice, dal, and all that. Actually, the government really did the good job, you know. They gave 1,000 rupees to the families who are having disability card, and they send all the ration. In spite of the ration being given in the ration shop, these persons with disabilities also got. So that really, you know, the mother is really looking very happy after she received the you know, the kit from the government, and also other people going and giving education to her at home. Next slide, ma'am. Yeah, this is a child with Down syndrome, and you know, she can sing, and she's nowhere star in the YouTube. And you know, she underwent surgery in the eye because she had squint eye. Now she can dance, and also as well as she can, you know, sing also. And the mother, you know, the mother who is wearing a green dupatta, she has really empowering her child to take the child to great heights. So next one, please, and I'll stop now. And this is a child with two children with you know, a peculiar disorder called MPS, and the mother has really empowered them. And next one, ma'am. Next one, please, hurry up. Yeah, this is Revati's house. Yeah, next one. Yeah, next, ma'am. Next, ma'am. Yeah, this is a cattail garden where a blind girl is being taught braille. Next one, ma'am, please. This child with a mental illness and mental retardation in the family has got so many medals during the pandemic because of her stepmother who has taken care of her. Next one, ma'am. Yeah, this is, we went to the children's house to celebrate the festivals. Next one. Next one, ma'am. Yeah, this is a child with autism who is a great singer. Next one. This is a child who was attacked by chickenpox twice, and we found a home for her because both the parents are getting old, and the home has taken care of her. And during the pandemic also, the home admitted her. Next one, please. Yeah, the parents being empowered. Next one. Yeah, this is a girl with low vision and mental retardation who has been empowered as a person with as a teacher. But she was scared to get married, but she wanted to get married. As Justice said, she got married finally, but completed her education. Next one, please. Yeah, this is, I think people with disabilities also have dreams. And as Madam Rekha, Madam said, people with, we want artificial friends for these people, you know, ma'am. And next slide, ma'am. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. And I heard many people who have talked about wonderful things, especially Justice ma'am and Rekha ma'am. Now waiting for Geeta ma'am to hear more from her. Thank you, Lata ma'am, for this opportunity. I'm so happy to be here on the centenary celebrations. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Vijayalakshmi ma'am, for voicing some of the experiences of children with disability managing the circumstances COVID-19 had thrust upon them. And your addresses shed light on some of the key challenges faced by women with disability during the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, and also the measures one can adapt to strengthen empowerment. Your service is highly appreciable, ma'am. Thank you once again. The pandemic has taken a toll on everyone's mental health, especially for women. Our next speaker for the evening is Dr. Geeta Premkumar, Director, Vector Intergenics Private Limited, Chennai, who's here to share her perceptions on psychological issues faced by women during pandemic. I request Ms. Vaijayanti Mukkala, AR, the University Women's Association, Madras, to introduce Dr. Geeta Premkumar.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I'm very happy to introduce Dr. Geeta Premkumar, Director, Vector Intergenics Private Limited. Dr. Geeta Premkumar is a well-known clinical psychological for almost 18 years. Dr. Geeta is an inspiration for me. She has, as a first-generation entrepreneur for the last 2 decades, Dr. Geeta has almost spent her entire career in dealing with human and being candid problems, holistic species with whom she comes. She has worked with Pertec Computers, Computer Point. She has been influential in molding students to become entrepreneurs and motivating the community. As a freelancer, guest faculty, and external trainer, she has been associated with renowned universities and institutes like BIT, Anna University, Bharat University, University of Madras, SAET, MOP Vaishnav College, Stella Maris, DJ Vaishnav, Ethiraj Institute, and many others. The alchemy of an achieving person relates on the two distinct virtues of pioneering spirit and willingness. Our guest speaker, who is a living idiom of women of perseverance and hard work, volunteered and organized many programs for Doordarshan Kendra Chennai, a television network on the concepts of women-related social issues. Her industry knowledge, interpersonal skills, and great achievements have been accompanied by striking awards. 3 awards which celebrate her success and achievements include Outstanding Achiever of Business Excellence, Business Achievement Award, Best Woman Entrepreneur Award, Best Woman Entrepreneur Award for International Category, and Best Entrepreneur ranked among top 5 women in the electronics industry in the country. She has contributed articles on child sexual abuse and governance policies on SME sector. I here represent Dr. Geeta Premkumar. Ma'am, the floor is yours.
I invite Dr. Geeta Premkumar to address us on women's mental health in the time of COVID-19 pandemic.
Good evening, one and all. I hope my voice is audible, right? Okay. Respected dignitaries,
yes,
and all the wonderful women who are here, I thank Mrs. Sri Lakshmi and Dr. NGR Jonathan College faculty for having given me this wonderful opportunity to be in midst of you on this wonderful occasion. Actually, as far as the pandemic is concerned, it has its own impact on everybody's life, and we are all aware. Just as a professional psychologist who dealt with COVID patients and COVID patients' relatives, so I have few thoughts to share. I have a small presentation. Is the screen visible?
No, ma'am.
One second, please.
Sure.
I'm also facing the same problem. Is it visible now?
No, ma'am.
Nikia, ask her to email it to you.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, can you send it to us? We will share it. Sure, yes, ma'am.
Email the presentation and you can take
it. Sure, ma'am.
Hello. I can send it right now. What is the email ID to which I have to? Oh, WhatsApp. Okay, fine. Yeah.
Ma'am, can you send?
Ma'am, it's in the chat box.
It through WhatsApp. Just.
Okay, ma'am. The email ID, we posted in the chat box, ma'am.
Sorry. I've sent it.
Okay, ma'am.
Have you received it?
We're checking that. We're checking our mail, ma'am.
Check your WhatsApp also.
Yeah, I sent it through WhatsApp.
Okay, ma'am.
Nitya ma'am, we are just checking over it.
Okay, can you worry, ma'am.
Anyway, I will. I just want to address a few common characteristics among the women. Being the women group, I think there are many characteristics which are extremely. I mean, it's a women characteristics. There are very few which I would like to highlight as a psychologist. See, normally women are highly sensible and responsible, which we can pat our own selves. But at the same time, we are highly sensitive also. And we are the people, we take initiatives in the family friend. At the same time, trivial issues always occupy our mind space more. To give an example, if the maid doesn't knock our door at the specified time, or if the milkman doesn't drop the milk packets in the early hours of the morning, we get really our day starts with a little bit of stress. As women, these type of trivial issues compared to men, Actually, men, they take these type of issues very commonly. But when a big issue come, when bigger problem come, actually, the women address the problem with a cool mind compared to men. We immediately settle to the reality and we normally take the issue and handle the issue. This you can see in any family. When the head of the family, when the husband, when he dies, when the woman, she undergoes a lot of stress due to the husband's demise, but at the same time, children are not left in the lurch. They are taken care of by the woman. She keeps all her emotional setbacks back and she starts focusing on what to be done next. And as far as the pandemic impact is concerned, see, this fear of unknown, unlike in the past, you know, we have faced a lot of natural calamities like floods, heavy rains, etc. But all these natural calamities were for a very short period. First time in this century, we faced something like this as a pandemic. And we first impact was the fear of unknown. It attacked every human being, however they are emotionally a strong person. That fear of unknown. So the phrase "life is uncertain" gained significance in the true sense of it. See, in the past we all know we keep telling that life is short. Life is uncertain, but still there was an inner feeling as if the future is all ours and I'm going to do all wonders. This is how the human life was focused, and I would say with a little more arrogance we were looking at our own lives. So the nature, the cosmic law, it hit really on our human intelligence. And it made us to feel that better be grounded and life is uncertain. So you, even tomorrow, the next moment is not sure. So that lesson was taught by us and it has its own impact. And of course, apart from this fear of losing the near and dear and the fear of economic impact, right from the maids or the economically downtrodden people to the white collar, the high salaried people, there was a low salary and the no salary. And in fact, as far as the women are concerned, we started losing our space at home. See, when in the normal situation prior to the pandemic, the children will leave, the husband will go to the office, or we will go to our work. And we had our own space in the at home and as well as in the society. But that space was lost because of that. And the increase in domestic work schedules. Obviously, women, always women, we had the Indian women, typically. The Indian women, we had a lot of domestic work, and the pandemic, it increased our domestic work schedules. And most of the families, women lost identity. See, you may smile if I say that even reading newspaper or watching TV, etc., the women's views were not ignored. See, for example, when they want to read the newspaper, when men are around, they were taking the newspaper, they were taking the magazines, even the TV. Probably a normal home will have probably two TVs. So that probably one TV will be occupied by the children and the other TV will the husbands will watch. So they were even little things of the sacrifice from trivial things it started. And the stress levels were mild to very severe among all the women. And apart from these pandemic stress, see, the women normally, the problems what we had, the PMT, the premenstrual tensions and the menopause problems, it added to the situation. In fact, health consultation was not available. So people were forced to live with pain. So women could not go to doctors because the hospitals were flooded with COVID patients, and the treatment was not available for the non-COVID, the regular checkups and the regular treatment. So they were forced to, still we are forced to live with pain, though the situation is little better. And as well as the common psychological impact, fear of being ruled. See, obviously in a home front, you know, many times in the Indian context, you see, exceptions are always there and we cannot take them as examples. Fear of being ruled among the domestic friend, that was always there in the women, because they had, as I told you earlier, they lost their space. And actually women, a lack of proper rest, because every time the cooking, the limited cooking scenario changed totally, because people were at home, children were at home, husband was at home. So they were, you make this recipe, why you are not making this? So these type of things, no, it really resulted, and they were tied up with the kitchens most of the time and without the help of the maids or cooks, because they couldn't allow the people inside. And lack of social and spiritual life. Actually, women primarily, if any function comes, we love to participate. We love to go to visit that spiritual places, temples, etc. And all this lack of social life had its own impact on all the most of the women. And another thing is, in fact, when I counseled, many people were depressed because they couldn't do personal grooming. All the beauty parlors were closed. So they felt that when they look at the mirror, they couldn't do any personal grooming. And to that extent, it had its own impact. And work from home, as well as the professional women are concerned. See, initially, women faced, it was very comfortable earlier. But later, it became very challenging. Because when you have a workspace, being at an office or at a school or college, you have your own infrastructure where you got used to it. But making that same infrastructure at home and delivering the same thing with an impact had its own challenges. And of course, parenting became all the more tough, because children were, all the children, because no schools and colleges, and they were all the time, they were at home. And the mothers became the punchbag literally in most of the houses. Because if you have adolescent children, no, they have their own space, they want to have their own privacy. And because they couldn't have that privacy, they were showing all that irritation on the mothers and the women and the elderly women at home. And in some cases, men cracking jokes among themselves just because they were there helping a woman in washing vessels or folding the clothes or cooking, etc. See, actually, one thing, it's all very good about Indian society, but always feeling as a person who has traveled widely, here only this domestic work is gender-based. Probably the women today between 20 to 30 will disagree with me, because there is a mind shift among the women, but primarily the women who are above 40 can understand. See, our own grandmothers and great-grandmothers, they have created a scene that men means you shouldn't touch the thorapathai eduthu perukka kudadu, neenga vandu indha work panna kudadu, andha work panna kudadu, appadina or sort of the work was gender based. So women were able to they were forced to do all the work. And when in the pandemic situation, when men were forced to do some domestic work, and they were cracking jokes, and they were making it as if they are doing out of the world work, which they never realized that this is what their woman is doing all the time, 365 days, 24/7. These type of things had its own impact on the women. See, among the overall, if you analyze the situation, see, normally the human life, if you take any human being, There are three types of problems we encounter. You can analyze in your own life. It may be you can classify all your problems into three primary headings, like health. Probably the problems will be of health, your personal health or your kith and kin health, and the financial problems and the relationships. Probably it will be A, B, or A and B, or B and C, or A and B, A and C. Sometimes it may be all the three. So, and always women, we are forced among the three choices. Either we have to be in the situation and we are forced to handle the situation, or we have to go against the situation, or we have to go away from the situation. In the pandemic, we were not go against the situation. If you take the domestic violence, or if the husband is so irritable, if the children are not able to understand the mothers, they were not able to go against the situation, and they were not able to go away from the situation also. They had to be in the situation and handle with all their usual tensions and stress. And mostly, if you see, the women were caught, all of us were caught among the thought traps. Literally, we were all in the thought traps. It was a trap. It was a thought trap. Not exactly in the domestic front or in the social front. Situation changed totally. We were primarily safe, barring a few parts of the world. But still, three emotions primarily dominated: the fear and undue imagination. Imagination in the negative sense of it. And our past experiences, we were forced to think about the past experiences because of this thought trap. So all these things really, it increased the pain in a woman's mind. So how we can handle primarily this, you may take it for yourself, or you may please pass this information to the women around, or even the us, because we need to take up the society around us together. So first, we have to understand what we want to do with our own life. I think most of the earlier dignitaries, they have covered and they have said so beautifully. So we have to really, we have to analyze and understand what we want with our own self. In a very patient manner, we have to ask this question to ourselves. And at this juncture, I would like to say that always success, the yardstick of success varies from one woman to another. So never compare your life with another woman, and never feel that you are a failure or you're a lesser person. Because everybody who comes to the ground to play cricket wants to become a Sachin Tendulkar, and the person who wants to act wants to become Amitabh Bachchan or a Rajinikanth. But life doesn't give that striking success to all the people. So the yardstick of success is just, you have to measure your life. How I was in 2015, how I was in 2018, how I was in 2020, and how I am today in 2021. Socially, emotionally, financially, or in handling relationships, or growing in a matured manner, how we are able to handle the situation. If your yardstick is satisfying, if your yardstick shows a satisfying score for your own self, I think you give a pat to yourself and smile with all the success feeling. Because where the problem comes is, when you start analyzing the other women or other relatives or other people in the society, and if you're going to, it is just an appreciation or looking above and, oh, fine, that is okay. But if you're going to think that, okay, A, woman is achieving this, B is achieving, C is achieving, I am not achieving anything, if that is going to push you down or bring a sort of jealousy feeling, it's a very dangerous story. So I always feel that self-motivate. Find out what you are good at. Even if you are not able to find what you are good at, there is nothing wrong. There is nothing wrong. You have your own plus, and you have lived your life all through life. what is success and what is failure. When the death comes, even the kings go to the graveyard and the beggars go. So the word success fades away the moment the person moves from the screen or moves from the media. So always count your own blessings rather than your own curses. And I want to tell that comments of others or their views, and you always think and tell yourself that I don't reflect them. Tell yourself again and again. This is how you have to handle your thoughts. Few solutions. Be aware that you are affected basically by thought process and try to redirect your thoughts. See, whenever you feel depressed or whenever you feel low in your own energy levels or when you feel disturbed, see, these are all the mild way where you have to be very careful, because if you don't watch your thought process, that will lead to depression. So many times we can always handle things at a very thought process level. And the moment you realize that your thoughts are getting into your trap, understand it and try to redirect just with your own way of relaxing your mood, maybe a music, somebody might read to die, like to read a book. You find your own ways. Even eating an ice cream, whatever it is, whatever little things, you just redirect your thoughts. Do not allow the situation or an emotion to overrule your life. Tell everybody, tell all the women around you, please don't allow the situation or an emotion to overrule your life. And if at all, if you feel that you are unable to control, do not hesitate to take professional help, because there are many psychologists, you can definitely seek their help and you can talk to them, you can take the professional help, and that stigma is no more. It is prevailing now in the Indian society, because if you take some 30 years back, going and consulting a psychiatric or a psychologist, it was considered enakena paithyama, enakena you are not normal, indha mari or comments ellam vandirundhathu, people were hesitating, but it is not so now. So do not hesitate to take professional help at the right moment, and give a loud thinking. There is no prudent or ideal situation for any person. Always in your life, when you encounter a problem, just give a loud thinking about that problem, and you have to take a decision about it. And always you cannot analyze and conclude that whether it is a 100% prudent decision. So whatever is sensible at that time, take a decision and build strength to face the consequences. Allow, again and again, I want to tell that don't fall into thought traps, cross the bridge when it comes. So that is how you have to take control of your own self. And last but not the least, I would like to quote the Janet Cole's words, "We cannot help ourselves without helping others. We cannot enrich our lives without enriching others. We cannot prosper without bringing prosperity to others." And with this, I close and I thank the organizers once again for having given me this opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you, Geeta ma'am. As you highlighted, the COVID-19 pandemic has had countless impact on women's physical and mental health. But moving forward, with mental health in mind, through resilience and positive behaviors amidst so much adversity, can calm down such an alarming situation. And you've also made us realize that one must also learn to prioritize mental health. Thank you once again, ma'am. As a means of expressing our gratitude, I invite Mrs. Kamala Mane, Secretary, University Women's Association of Madras, to propose a vote of thanks.
Unmute yourself, Kamala.
Oh, thank you for letting me know that. Good evening, one and all. I thank the Honorable Chief Justice, Dr. Anita Sumanth, Madras High Court, Chennai. Respected speakers, Dr. Rekha Shetty, Managing Director, Five Star Distribution Network, Chennai. Dr. Vijayalakshmi, former Head Medical Sciences and NIPED, Chennai, Dr. Geeta Prem Kumar, Director of Vector Indo Gymnics Chennai, and all the participants. It is such a honor for me to get this opportunity to thank all the dignitaries on behalf of the University of Women's Association Madras. I would like to express my gratitude to all the esteemed dignitaries for their presence and contribution to make this webinar a great success. Today's webinar, CCI IFUA meet, would be memorable and marked day in our UWAM calendar, as it is our centenary celebration happening during the pandemic. The topics discussed today will be an eye-opener to many women in all walks of life and a motivation to come over the crisis faced by them in this era. The inspiring words of all our speakers will make us face the challenges with courage. I extend my gratitude to our honorable chief guest for taking our time out for busy schedule to grace the occasion. Thank you for inspiring and encouraging us with your words on this special day. A special thanks to Dr. Lata Rajendran, President, University of Women's Association, Chennai, for providing immense support to make this webinar successful. I extend my gratitude to the executive committee members, other members of the UPUA, UWAM, and the MGR Janaki College for Women, Chennai, to organize a webinar amidst the pandemic. I would like to end this short speech with a quote. Behind every successful woman is a tribe of other women who has her back. Thank you once again for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, Mrs. Kamala Mani. May I request all the ladies to turn on their webcams to pose for a photo? Kanimuri ma'am?
Yes ma'am, some of them have not yet turned the camera.
May I request the ladies to turn on their webcams or cameras to pose for a photograph?
Please switch on your videos, please.
Kindly switch on your videos.
Nitya ma'am, just a minute. I make a Maithili ma'am to on the video. Just a minute.
Yeah, sure ma'am. Mm-hmm.